Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Mother's Day to mothers, aunts, sisters, grandmothers, grandaunts, and anyone else who has mothered a person in your lives. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God, whose Son Jesus is the Good Shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Down the road, away in Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha, gazelle in our language. She was well known for doing good and helping out. During the time Peter was in the area, she became sick and died. Her friends prepared her body for burial and put her in a cool room. Some of the disciples had heard that Peter was visiting in nearby. Lydda sent two men to ask if he would be so kind as to come over. Peter got right up and went with them. They took him into the room where Tabitha's body was laid out. Her old friends, most of them widows, were in the room mourning. They showed Peter pieces of clothing the gazelle had made while she was with them. Peter put the widows all out of the room. He knelt and prayed. Then he spoke directly to the body. Tabitha, get up. She opened her eyes. When she saw Peter, she sat up. She took her hand and helped her up. Then he called in the believers and widows and presented her to them alive. When this became known all over Joppa, many put their trust in the master. Peter stayed on a long time in Joppa as a guest of Simon the Tanner.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You anointed my head with oil. My cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from John. I looked again. I saw a huge crowd, too huge to count. Everyone was there, all nations and tribes, all races and languages, and they were standing dressed in white robes and waving palm branches, standing before the throne, the Lamb and Hartley singing, salvation to our God on his throne, salvation to the Lamb. All who were standing around the throne, angels, elders, animals, fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, oh yes, the blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving, the honor and power and strength to our God forever and ever. Oh yes. Just then, one of the elders addressed me. Who are these dressed in white robes? And where did they come from? Taken aback, I said. Oh, sir, I have no idea, but you must know. Then he told me, these are who come from the great tribulation, and they washed their robes, scrubbed them clean in the blood of the Lamb. That's why they're standing before God's throne. They serve him day and night in his temple. The one on the throne will pitch his tent there for them. No more hunger, no more thirst, no more scorching heat. The Lamb on the throne will shepherd them, will lead them to spring waters of life, and God will wipe every last tear from their eyes. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to John.
They were celebrating Hanukkah just then in Jerusalem. It was winter. Jesus was strolling in the temple across Solomon's porch. The Jews circling him said, "How long are you going to keep us guessing? If you're Messiah, tell us straight out." Jesus answered, "I told you, but you don't believe everything I have done has been authorized by my Father. Actions that speak louder than words. You don't believe because you're not my sheep. My sheep recognize my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them a real and eternal life. They are protected from the destroyer for good. No one can steal them from out of my hand. The Father who put them under my care is so much greater than the destroyer and thief. No one could ever get them away from him. I and the Father of our one heart and mind."
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of the Father who loves us, the Son that saves us, the Holy Spirit that guides us, May the words of your mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my Redeemer. Please be seated. It's a good morning on this is the fourth Sunday of Easter, the Sunday of the Good Shepherd. And I'll begin by wishing every mother and everyone with motherly responsibilities, characteristics, and features a very happy Mother's Day. And I know you came in as a happy mother, but the men of the church will be ensuring that you leave a happier mother, and in some cases, the happiest mother, after our brunch today. Today is Good Shepherd. I hope I didn't oversell us. Today is the Sunday of the Good Shepherd and Mother's Day. And in preparing this sermon and addressing the two that we're celebrating today, I realized that the two personalities, the shepherd and the mother, are two concepts that are more similar than apart. I'll begin by sharing a boyhood experience. Years ago, growing up in Linden, Guyana, my grandfather, who lived in the countryside, gifted my mother three chickens. They were new to me, and so I was replete with excitement. Being the youngest boy and the youngest kid, I was tasked with caring for the chickens for the first time. Over time, no doubt, those chickens multiplied and became quite a few in number. Added to this, I took care of the dogs and at one point a monkey, turtles, and so on, but the chickens meant a lot to me. Prior to this, I knew nothing about chickens nor how to rear them, but over time, I learned them and they learned me. Chickens eat grain, I learned. They drink water with their heads tilted. They retire for the evening very early. They like to perch high when they're sleeping. They will go back exactly where they laid the eggs to sit on them to hatch them. And you can also imagine them, and you can also examine them to know if they are about to lay. As a boy, I did find that amusing. The chickens, in turn, knew that when I came down in the morning with the red and white container, it was time to gather to be fed, and they did that spontaneously. If I was going to the coop in the evening to open the door, it was time to follow me indoors. If they had just hatched chicks and I was hovering over them to play with their baby chicks as I was fond of, it was time for them to get protective. If I caught them to clip their wings or examine them, they grew to learn that there was no reason to fear me. I knew them and they knew me. I protected them as best I could, and they trusted my protecting presence. There I was, playing shepherd by taking care of them in a way that protected them and met their needs. In today's reading, God is heavily characterized as our shepherd. Time and again, we read Psalm 23 ever so often. But what does it mean to us as we internalize that Psalm of David? The Psalm is replete with motives of God caring for us as his sheep in the most protective and gentle ways. The experience of this Psalm is perfect safety and security in the darkest of times. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. This speaks to satisfaction, be it material, physical, or emotional. Green pastures, signifying rich and plenty. Still waters, a peace and calm that transcends all understanding. He restoreth my soul, making me whole when I am broken. Walking through the valley of the shadow of death, yet fearing no evil. Guiding us successfully through the trials of this life. Prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Even those who despise you will have to be in awe of your plenty and satisfaction, thanks to the Good Shepherd, our Lord. Jesus, as the shepherd in this psalm, takes care of the whole person, nurturing, feeding, protecting, sheltering, soothing. And to do all of this, two ingredients are required. To know who you are caring for and to love them unconditionally. It's not easy to care, nurture, and soothe someone at all times. The person on the receiving end of the care doesn't always make it easy, but you know that they need it. Try to save a drowning person. Jesus loves and knows us in ways only he can. Last week, Reverend Rose preached about the love of God experienced by Thomas, the agape and the philia. Philia, which describes encompassing love for fellow humans, care, respect, and compassion for people in need. Aren't those the attributes the God as our shepherd recognizes in us? I can tell you that many times those chickens I cared for angered me. They took away my playing time or they made me tired. But the only thing they experienced was my care and kindness. My frustration was welled up in here. They didn't feel that. It is the same that characterizes the love of God. In the book of Isaiah, our righteousness is described as filthy rags, yet we are always on the receiving end of God's benevolence. Do we recognize, value, and hearken to the voice and actions of our shepherd? Let me come back to this question after pondering today's gospel reading, where Jesus is being challenged by the Jews that, is he really the Messiah and the Son of God? They were demanding that Jesus tell them that he is the Messiah. They were seeking to be convinced that Jesus was indeed the Messiah sent by God. They articulated their disbelief in who he was and what he was meant to be. But Jesus summed it up aptly by saying, if he was really the Messiah, in the face of all of them questioning whether he was still the Messiah, Jesus summed it up by saying, if you are my sheep, you know my voice. And I'm going to ask this question with the deepest of love. The deepest of love for you. Is Jesus your Messiah? Like the Jews, we can have the bishop, the canons, diocesan officials, priests, lay people. They can proclaim the word of God and God can speak through them to you. But my friends, unless you open your hearts and your minds and be receptive to what God is saying to you, you will not hear it. It may be for that reason that one of Jesus' favorite refrains at the end of a parable is, he who hath an ear, let him hear. So the question is, do we hear the voice of God? Do you cast your mind to that time in your life when you ask the questions, what is the use of my faith? Where is God? Does God know I need him? When you get to that point, remind yourself that God has blessed us with a lot of things, but God has blessed us with two ears and one mouth. We listen twice as much as we speak. And this is the time that you put that into action and listen twice to God. Quietly. So instead of chastising God, double down on the use of your spiritual ear and listen for his voice. If you are his sheep, you will hear his voice. It is common, however, to place ourselves in the role of the sheep, as we know God is our shepherd. But how are we as shepherds? A shepherd must have unconditional love. Love beyond boundaries. Shepherds loved their sheep and took good care of them. They spent day and night with their sheep to protect them from wild animals and dangerous places that might harm them. And they led their flocks to good food and clear water. If the flock was not too large, shepherds often give each sheep a name, and the sheep knows that. Jesus does the same for us and expects the same from us as we shepherd our fellow man. Jesus is likened to the Lamb of God. All powerful, all encompassing, he still became not a sheep, not an adult version, the child version, a lamb. Meekness, purity, innocence, and humility. How are we shepherding those that God has placed in our charge? Is our love nurturing? Is our agape and our filia, are our agape and filia strictly conditional? In a song written by the group, a hymn written by the group The Grace Thrillers, it says, "There were 99 that safely lay in the shelter of the flock, but one was out on the hills away, far off in the cold and dark, away on the mountains wild and bare, away from the tender shepherd's care. Lord, they asked, thou hast here thy 99. Are they not enough for thee? But the shepherd, he answered and said, this of mine has wandered away from me." And all the song goes on to say that although the road be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. But none of the ransomed ever knew how deep were the waters crossed, nor how dark was the night which the Lord passed through and found his sheep that was lost. You have $100,000 and your investment banker tells you he lost $1,000. Huh? Or you have $100 million and you lose $1 million. Huh? This was not the case of God's unconditional love. 99, and the one sheep is away, far off. Ask yourself the question, what would be your reaction? It strikes me that this is the reason Jesus used the analogy of the shepherd. Because of that uncompromising love and care for us. Note he didn't say servant and master, leader and follower, brother and sister, nor father and child, but shepherd and sheep. That's a special relationship which embodies love, care, affection, and attention, which comes from sacrifice. Throughout the Old Testament, but with special pointedness in the prophetic books, the kings and other rulers of Israel and Judah are called shepherds. This designation makes sense because kings and rulers were entrusted with looking out for the welfare of God's people. They were responsible for defending from attack, for administering justice, for taking care of the poor and needy, and for making provisions for the worship of the Lord. But the same way all rulers and kings who were shepherds of God's people were not always the best shepherds, they were not always very good shepherds. I know you may say that is not my problem. The priest is my shepherd. You, Jerrick, and your fellow vestry people, you are the shepherds. That's your responsibility. We are just going to lead. I have some disappointing news for you. At the back of your bulletin, it says, all God's people are the ministers of God. We are all ministers of God. God requires us to minister to everyone, regardless how lowly and insignificant in your eyes that ministry appears. Being ministers of God, in our own way, perpetually, we are all shepherds as we are sheep. We all have a ministry. And how are you as a shepherd in your ministry? Is your love unconditional? Do you see Jesus in everyone you behold? Is your impact that of kindness with the goal of bringing out the best in those you serve in God's place? Are you willing to cross the waters and the dark desert to find the one lost sheep in the ministry God has given you charge of? I return to my earlier attributes that makes God unique in his love for us and ask if you can identify with those. You must know who you are caring for and you must love them unconditionally. As instruments of God's being, we must see our fellow Christian and fellow man the way God sees his sheep, in need of guidance, leadership characterized by God's love. It is not enough to say, oh, I'm performing my service to God and you do the best you can. We are responsible to each other. That is why God has us here. And as we recognize mothers today, we know that they are full of unconditional love. You know, some people with different attributes, you will say to them sometimes, I don't know, I know we say it a lot in Guyana, only a mother could love you. And that speaks to what a mother's love really is. I know my mother's love for me is undying and uncompromising. So that's my experience. I don't know it's everybody else's, but I know that her love and mothers in general, their love cross boundaries and distance. Kalinda, you are excluded from that analogy. Mothers are known for nurturing us from the time that we were born. The attachment and unconditional love of a mother is like the shepherd's love and care for his sheep. So today, my brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge God as our shepherd. Not only hear, but listen to his voice. And let us be the good shepherds to every life we touch and serve. Amen.
We believe in one
God, the Father, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made.
Our tradition is to have the leader part read by different people. If you feel called to read a section, we invite you to do so. Sometimes more than one person may begin reading, which is fine. Please continue to read together. It's wonderful to hear more than one voice when that happens. Risen Lord. Let us give thanks to God for the multitude of blessings he showers upon us, for our lives and for those whom we love, for the beauty of this home God has created for us, for our families and our friendships, Let us give thanks to the God of life. We pray this month for the worship committees, Part 1, Altar Guild, Bulletin Assembly, Ministry, Ushers and Greeters, Welcomers Worship Team. We pray this month of May, which is Asian Pacific American Heritage and Jewish American Heritage Month. Do we have anyone celebrating birthdays?
Yes, my son Russell Simpson, his birthday was yesterday.
Roger's Prothro's birthday is today.
Okay.
Did you say Chester?
All right. For birthdays, watch over your children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Do we have anyone celebrating anniversaries today, or in the week past or to come? Okay. Let us pray for the church that it may carry forward the redemptive works of God, for our clergy and our bishops, for the many lay people who serve the church and serve the world through the church, for those gathered here in worship and prayer. Risen Lord, let us pray for the newly baptized, that the joy of Easter may ever grow within them and that the Spirit may guide them in lives of active faith. Risen Lord,
let us pray for the nations and peoples of the world, that the powers that oppress and destroy may decline, and that justice, peace, and prosperity be lifted up.
For Ukraine, Ethiopia, and other war-torn areas in the world,
risen Lord,
hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who are sick, those who suffer, those who struggle, and those who have died. For Vincent, Nancy, Diana, Saul, Mary Mead, Harrison and his father Bob Jens, Allison, Janice, and Abosi. In the hope born of Easter, give them peace, acceptance, and renewal, and may they, through their struggles, come into closer communion with the God who redeems and restores. Risen Lord, please share the names of anyone traveling this week. O God, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, in particular all these gathered here and those who travel with them. Surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let us conclude our prayers by praying together.
O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of the bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold in him all his redeeming works, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
You everyone, happy Mother's Day to all your moms and daughters and sisters.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers.
Happy Mother's Day.
Yeah, wait, you see, they must say something there.
Good morning, everyone, again, and happy Mother's Day for those of you who didn't hear me say that early. Most of and almost all our announcements are later on in the service, but I need to talk to you about how we are distributing communion, because there are many of you who are here who haven't been here since we are now offering wine, consecrated wine again. And of course, COVID is not over, and so this is what we will do. First choice is you can still continue to receive communion only by receiving the host in your hands. If I'll be standing basically exactly where I am right now, come up, and let me put this mic away before I drop it. And just put your hands out like this. You can take the host and then go back to your seat. Option number two is if you want me to dip the wafer in the wine, there will be somebody over here next to me who will have a cup of wine that no one will drink out of. And if you come up to me then, put your hands up like this so I know that you want me to take the host, dip it in the wine, and then I will drop it in your hands again. Again, the whole point is my hands are so sterilized by the end of Sunday, I have to keep putting hand cream on my hand all day long just to know how, I mean, I've sterilized my times through the piece 3 times already. If you want to drink out of the cup, come over here, get communion from me, and then step over right here, and another person will hold the cup so you can drink it. After every person who drinks, the cup will be wiped and turned around. So those are your 3 options, and if you need more direction when you come up here, my mic is off at that point, if I remember, and ask, because if you all of a sudden get a host in your hand and want to intinct it, I can't take it back again, but I will have extra hosts, and I will take a fresh host and intinct it, dip it or intinct it in, and you just get 2 hosts that day. So I just wanted to say that. I'm sorry for those of you who have been here every single Sunday since Palm Sunday. You've heard that now a lot of times, but it is better to go over it for people who haven't been in church for a while. Anyway, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We praise you and we bless you, holy and gracious God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being. Sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again you called us to live in the fullness of your love. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. And so this day we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Deliver us from the power of sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine again. He gave thanks to you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ, crucified and risen, who was and is to come. We offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Rule your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with Saint Andrew and all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all to you be the honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore let us keep the feast. Alleluia!
Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in this blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. So, come to this table. You who have much faith, and you who would like to have more, you who have been to the sacrament often, and you who have not been here for a long time, you who have tried to follow Jesus, and you who have failed, come. It is Christ who invites us to meet him here.
Mother's Day.
Let us pray. God of all, we give you thanks and praise at when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. May Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us God's children through the resurrection of the only begotten Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of God's blessing.
Amen.
May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance. And the blessing of God, who creates us, comes to us in human form, who continually breathes new life into us, be with you this Easter season and to the end of time.
Amen. Amen.
The first announcement is we have a presentation on video of all the from the children of the parish, and many people in the chancel may want to go and watch it. So the way to do that is to go out there, and so that gives Lucini time to boot it up and everything, so we can, the rest of us can come down and see it. Yes. And then there will be a second presentation from the men's ministry. I didn't mean to forget the men at all.
Write it down a thousand times for a little word that makes me cry. How I feel about it, I can't.
Mother's Day.
Joan the Rutherford, and this is the H for mother. The H to me stands for the happiness my mom gives or shows me. I am automatically happy when my
write it down a thousand times for a little word that makes me cry. How I feel about it, I can't.
Motivational.
O is for open and mother's overload of love. Her love is never ending and unconditional.
T is for doctor. Mom, you always think of events to prepare me for the future. You inspire me to be the best that I can be. You are my hero. Happy Mother's Day.
Joan the Rutherford. And this is the H for mother. The H to me stands for the happiness my mom gives or shows me. I am automatically happy when my mom is happy. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers in the world.
Hi, my name is Jerrick and Rutherford, and this is the H in mother. A mother is someone who provides you happiness and joy and is very helpful and will never be disappointed in you no matter how angry she looks or sounds. She will do her best to make sure your life is perfect. Happy Mother's Day to all mothers in the world.
E is for everybody wants to be like mom. Mom is awesome.
R is for reliable.
You can make everything possible just because of you. You are the best mom in the world.
Yeah.
I thank you for making our dinners.
Yeah.
And we hope you have a best Mother's Day.
Yeah.
Bye. I love you.
Bye.
Yeah.
Write it down a thousand times for a little word that makes me cry. How I feel about it, I can't decide. No, I don't know, so I'll improvise. Isn't living in our heart or in our mind? I don't know, so we're ready or not. Here I go, searching for the answer. And I'm not gonna stop till I find where it lives inside. Afraid and alone, we'll be there when the storm rises up, when the shadows descend. Every beat of my heart, every second I need, every promise I made, baby, that's what I'll give.
So much to clean up. So much to do. No. Okie dokie.
Well, two wonderful presentations. And so other announcements, and if you can, go at the end of the service, don't go home, because the men's ministry has definitely prepared a feast. And so this is my first one here, so that will be a lot of fun for me. I will say that also, before any of the men go downstairs, anyone who is on the altar guild and here today, or an usher and here today, I want to take your pictures because we're preparing bulletin boards for the ministry of the month. This is part one of worship, so I want to say it'll be nicer if I take them in church. And I'm not going to say anything else. Please read them. We have so many events coming up, and we have a line over here, a two-person line already. So I'll let them speak, and we've got a pile of events coming up, and they're in the blast, they're in your bulletin, and there's a sheet in the back of the church with a list of everything that you're doing. So thank you.
Just two quick announcements. One on May 29th is, we'll be celebrating the 56th independence of Guyana as an independent nation. And we'll be celebrating that on the 29th. The Independence Day is actually the 26th. We do plan to have a service imbued with Guyanese culture, so all people of Guyanese heritage, half heritage, quarter heritage, or this is a good time for you to be naturalized to a Guyanese. I'll ask Reverend Coates to baptize you Guyanese, and you can come support us and celebrate with us. I'll be sending out an email this week, but just know that it's the 29th of May. Thank you.
Reverend Rose already mentioned it, but on behalf of the men's ministry, and I must say with help from some of the our wonderful women, we do invite you down to our Mother's Day feast. So we'll see you after the service.
Thank you.